Coffey each 2 minutes for roughing. For Edmonton, Okusiak 2 minutes for roughing as players on. So the penalties are all equal. But we will be going 3-on-3 now. And that certainly opens up the ice for Wayne Gretzky. This is an icing against the Blackhawks. We have played a minute 57 of this first period. And Wayne Gretzky now has the ice to himself.
Oh, and this is when he really loves it, Al, because the more room he has to manipulate out there, the more productive Wayne Gretzky can be. And of course, this brings up an even tougher job for number 19 of the Blackhawks, Troy Murray, who is responsible for covering Gretzky and trying to keep him out. Now let's watch Gretzky. He's got plenty of room here, and right after those penalties were handed out, he tried to take advantage of it very quickly. He went to his backhand. He didn't waste any time trying to get a shot on Bannerman.
His scoring streak was snapped Thursday night at 37 games in a row in which he has scored a point. And now it is Bob Murray coming out, crisscrossing with Secord. He shoots, rebound in front, and Secord hits the side of the net. Troy Murray gobbles up the puck in the slot. Cross ice he goes. Bob Murray shoots, and it's blocked by Randy Clark. Smothered in the corner by Secord. And now Edmonton has the puck. It is lugged out to center ice as Larry Melnick puts on the move. Onto the skate of Gretzky. He's played off by Troy Murray. And Bob Murray takes it behind his net with Gretzky chasing after him. Troy Murray comes out. It's me and my shadow with Troy Murray and Gretzky. Here is Troy Murray. And it's poked away. Gretzky eludes Dupont. And here's Gretzky chasing after it. Gretzky against Bannerman. Scores! Gretzky beats Jerome Dupont and then beats Murray Bannerman.
That's exactly what happens when Wayne Gretzky has a lot of ice out there. Jerome Dupont, number 25, a young player back in the blue line for the Blackhawks, made a big mistake here. He tried to take the piece of the body on Gretzky, but that's not easy to do, as many players will tell you in this league. Gretzky's not an easy man to take the body and keep it out on him. Gretzky just fakes, deeks, and puts that puck by the fallen Murray Bannerman. Dupont got a piece of Gretzky, but a piece isn't good enough. You've got to get the whole man, otherwise Wayne Gretzky was home free.
And Gretzky waiting and waiting for Bannerman to make the move, so he gets his second goal of this series. And it's 1-0 in favor of the Oilers. Charlie Huddy puts on the brakes to Fogelin. Fogelin knocked down by Bergevin. And it is Dennis Savard making his first appearance on the ice, and now he's winding it up, and the crowd comes alive. Savard. Back it goes to Bergevin. Across to Dupont. He can't hold on. Behind the net, Huddy. Turned around by Savard. Still 3-on-3. As the Oilers bust in, this is Messier. Messier in front. As he is dumped behind the net by Randy Boyd. Revving it out is Bergevin. Leaves it for Savard. And it's blocked by Melnick. O'Callaghan cannot keep it in. 4 minutes gone by in the first period, and the Oilers have struck first. In game three, Chicago had scored the first two goals, and that certainly enabled them to play their kind of game. Now, they're behind. O'Callaghan's pass, knocked down by Gretzky. Plays it off the board as Anderson, right in front, steered aside by Bannerman. Cross ice, but it is blocked by O'Callaghan. Right in front, Anderson, and it's poked away by Bannerman. The chase for the puck. O'Callaghan, he goes cross ice. Sutter shoots. Goal!
Tell it all. Darryl Sutter puts his Blackhawk team right back into this hockey game. Great shot just over the blue line. It beats Grant Fuhr, but I think that puck was deflected off of an Edmonton Oilers defenseman stick. And so it changed direction, caught Fuhr off guard, and the Blackhawks are even.
Darryl Sutter, the leading goal scorer for the Blackhawks, has just hit double figures for the playoffs. His 10th playoff goal. He scored the game winner Thursday night, which is his fourth game winner in the playoffs. Here's Coffey streaking in. Saved by Bannerman. And we have a penalty coming up. A penalty to the Oilers. The Blackhawks have tied it up. Now they will be on a power play when we return 1-1 in Chicago.
Wayne Gretzky was pretty upset by it all, and we will see on the replay of Callahan just winding up and taking a pretty good two-hander there, and that's unfortunately for the Blackhawks right in front of referee Ron Hogarth's eyes, and so the Oilers will do their thing on the power play.
They've had 10 power play attempts in this series against Chicago, have scored on two of them. What's the 29 for the Hawks against Gretzky? Back to the point. Kevin Lowe. Hops over the stick of Anderson. It is Gretzky in the corner. Kept in by Gregg. Across to Lowe. He fires, and it whizzes wide. Kept in by Randy Gregg. Here's Anderson. His pass deflected away. Lowe takes the look. Randy Gregg. Gretzky smothered. Still has it. Works in front. And it is cleared and out.
Blackhawks will miss Billy Gardner tonight, one of their key penalty killers, who was injured in the game Thursday night. Not an easy man to replace because he has been specifically assigned to kill penalties here for the last few years.
Not out. Here's Lowe walking in. Side of the net. And it's saved by the defense. Bergevin takes the play. And now the Blackhawks break out. Led by Savard. Savard weaving in and out of traffic. But an offside is called against Chicago.
Fans are so loud here that the players are having great difficulty, as they did on Thursday night, hearing that whistle. Dennis Savard and Bergevin, they just definitely did not hear that whistle, and they just continued play.
Let me catch up on the goals. Gretzky, his eighth of the playoffs, from Gregg and Melnick. As you see, the Oilers setting it up.
Well, they had perfect opportunity here, but yet some fine penalty killing. Great anticipation here by number two, Mark Bergevin, for the Hawks. He just cut off that pass. The Hawks have done an excellent job killing penalties here at home, especially. They have killed 25 of the last 27 effectively at home, 92.6%.
1-1 the score. Gretzky's goal came at 2:52, then Sutter's goal came at 4:23 from O'Callaghan, and Bannerman gets another assist. He got the last assist in Thursday's game. They open that goal. 6 minutes into this first period. Bannerman stops it for his defense. And then he whips it around the board. It pops three. And deflected by Bob Murray. 40 seconds to go. And the penalty to O'Callaghan. Charlie Huddy. Picks Coffey. On the fly. And Bannerman stops it. But the Oilers were in offside. So the Oilers unable to get on track on this power play.
With 26 seconds remaining on Jack O'Callaghan's penalty for the Blackhawks. Murray Bannerman had done such an excellent job using his stick in game number three here, frustrating Edmonton numerous times by almost acting as an extra defenseman. And an extra defenseman, Bob Fulford says, I can use right now in this series.
Well, Darryl Sutter's goal tied it up. That won't be another game winner for Sutter, but certainly an important goal showing more of the character of the Blackhawks after falling behind. Quickly, 1-0, come right back. Mike Gretzky back skating into his own zone. Cross ice to Curry, who also was shut out in game number three. Troy Murray actually doing the job on Gretzky. It was two for the price of one. You stop Gretzky, you also stop Curry.
Now the Edmonton Oilers were not very effective against Murray Bannerman. And Bannerman, when he is hot, boy, he is really tough to put those pucks by. Yari Curry will attest to that. Yari Curry, of course, with Wayne Gretzky being covered, has a much more difficult time at scoring. The Oilers indicated that they might put Mike Krushelnevsky up a fair amount tonight with Gretzky and Yari Curry, for the reason being Krushelnevsky hasn't really done too much at all in the playoffs, and they were hoping to get Krushelnevsky going. He wasn't going on that third or fourth line.
Well, with Semenko out in the penalty box, they get a chance right here. Here's the pass side of the net with Krushelnevsky waiting and poised in front. 4 seconds on the penalty. Looks at this jump. Loud calling for a penalty on the Oilers there. They do not get it. Team's now at equal strength. 13 minutes, 15 seconds to go in the first. Here is Curry. Bannerman got a piece of that one. Gretzky behind the net, right in front, but the quick stick by Bannerman gets it out of danger. Krusinski, his back pass, as the Hawks diving all over the ice. Bob Murray starts out. And Fuhr guides that into the corner. 7 minutes gone in this first period. 1-1, Blackhawks and the Oilers. Lysiak chasing after Coffin, and he gets him from behind with a stick. Secor can't keep it in. O'Callaghan, who has been playing inspired hockey for the Blackhawks on the back line. Coffey almost loses. Great forechecking again by Chicago. But now it is Coffey winding out with Secord's stick on him. Secord, number 20, eludes the check, and Lysiak shoots it down. It is low for Edmonton, chasing back. Icing had been waved off on the play. Fogelin comes in off the board for Lindstrom and Jerome Dupont. Lays it across to Boyd. Back on the boards. It is low being checked there by Sutter. And a two-line pass is called. And we have a whistle with 12 minutes to go in the first period. For our local systems, we pause now. It's the Stanley Cup playoffs on USA. Pass goes. And the Blackhawks all over the Oilers as Kozar wrapped up by Patterson. Anderson as Dupont takes a run at him. Randy Gregg for Edmonton.
Dupont's going to make sure this time. He's going to try to anyway. When he gets a piece of the man, he's going to try and get the whole man.
And there go the sticks again. Lysiak taking the look as Dupont gets his stick up there, saying, and he said, in defense.
Ron Hogarth, meanwhile, telling Dupont to get out of here and stay out of it. Otherwise, you're going to be going to the penalty box. Tempers are very hot right now. They were not cooled off after that early first period fight. And if Al Secord is out there in the ice, you may see some more good body checking going on. Glenn Anderson, number 9 for the Oilers, had an excellent opportunity earlier in this first period when he walked right in front of Bannerman and just held on to that puck too long. Sometimes the Oilers can be guilty of that, Al. They can try and make it look too pretty instead of getting the job done early. Glenn Anderson, with great speed and great puck control, just waited much too long.
He has been the sniper, the big scorer against the Blackhawks down through the course of the last couple of seasons. Messier leaves it. And it is Kozar who comes out, being bodied by Secor. Messier loses, but it comes to Gregg. On the screen, kicked out by Bannerman. And a penalty coming up. Another penalty to Chicago, it appears. We are in the Chicago Stadium. You are watching the Stanley Cup playoffs on USA. We'll be back.
Bob Pulford, the Leafs vet, Ben Wilson, is still in the penalty box, as you can see, and so, once again, the defensive force for the Blackhawks going down.
A lot of ice time early for Mark Bergevin. Here's Coffey in front. There's some snipers right there. The sticks out. Gretzky to Krusinski. Takes the long look. Cross ice is Curry. Unable to get to the puck, and Troy Murray blasts this down. 20 seconds gone by on the penalty to Bob Murray of the Blackhawks. 1-1 the score. The Oilers and the Hawks. Coffey puts on the brakes. Leads in Krusinski. 43-goal scorer this year in his first season with Edmonton. Gretzky. Back it goes to Huddy. Coffey with Yari Curry. Moving in front. He shoots. Save Bannerman.
Just stood his ground. Once again, the Oilers trying to work themselves into not just a good shooting position, a perfect shooting position. Yari Curry hanging onto that puck and wheeling out into the slot, trying to set up a screen as well as getting in the best shooting position possible. He fires that puck. Bannerman kicks it right back out. A little bit of a rebound there. The Oilers not able to capitalize on it, however. A lot of pressure on some young Blackhawk defensemen out there right now in this first period. Jerome Dupont, and of course Randy Boyd and Mark Bergevin, three players that have not had much NHL experience.
Also the pressure on Troy Murray, number 19. one of the fine penalty killers for the Blackhawks. He had four shorthanded goals during the course of the season. So the extra duty for Troy Murray, he has to kill penalties, and there have been plenty of them already. Plus, he has to take the shift and try to shadow Gretzky. It is Troy Murray on the faceoff. Olczyk picks it up. Here's Olczyk trying to split the defense. He moves in and shoots. Score! It happened only five times during the course of the season. Bannerman steals that one off. The Blackhawks have come from behind and have a 2-1 lead against the Oilers.
Oh, that's got to make Olczyk feel awfully good right now, because he's been trying to put a puck by Grant Fuhr. And you can see the move that he made to Paul Coffey's right. Olczyk just moving to his left, his natural leaning position, in order to get a good shot away, and just blasted that puck.
Two goals against Fuhr, Gary. Two long-distance goals. Fuhr, who has gone all the way for the Edmonton Oilers in the playoffs, he has played all but 5 minutes. Could he be getting tired? And it's a tough thing for a goaltender. I think a goaltender would rather play in succession than have to take 2 days off, as Fuhr has, but then again, so is Bannerman.
Well, you bring up a good point. Of those two goals that the Blackhawks have scored, they have been by no means great scoring opportunities. They have been from quite a distance out.
Troy Murray was also added on that goal for the assist. Still 45 seconds to go in the Chicago penalty to Bob Murray. The Blackhawks, after being embarrassed the first two games in Edmonton and written off by most, now looking to tie the series up. Messier races right on the scene. Anderson is bothered by 19-year-old Bergevin, who steps into the spotlight tonight. And snapped down by Lutzer. 20 seconds left in the power play for the Oilers. Al Albert, along with Gary Green and Al Conrick, bringing you all the Stanley Cup action on USA. Messier stick handling over the line. He is pinned into the boards. Sports loose. O'Callaghan saw Gretzky behind, and that goes the other way. Here's Messier, stick handling in. He shoots, scores! Bannerman took the chance, and he lost. Messier, I don't even believe, was looking at the net when he scored, and it's tied at two.
Unfortunately for the Hawks, those inexperienced defensemen are costing them right now on that first goal. No question, DuPont was at fault, not getting a total piece of Gretzky. This time, it was number two, Mark Bergevin, that went down, committed himself way too early on Mark Messier. You've got to stand up. You've got to play the body here. You can see Bergevin going down. Messier, he's too smart for that. He just walks right around, then Bibbitz turns to his backhand. And as you said, Al, Bannerman went down plenty early here. Watch the move Messier makes on Bergevin. Bergevin goes diving out at him, and Bannerman, he goes down way too early as well. Two Blackhawks go down, and Messier puts the puck up high.
Well, Bannerman figuring he's all alone. He made the move, and he got part of the stick, but unable to get it away from Messier. Unassisted, Messier scores at 11:02, and now it is McClellan, number 24, on the ice for the first time for Edmonton, and he squares off against number 32 for the Blackhawks, Randy Boyd. Heating up even more here in Chicago. And for our local systems, we'll pause now. USA Sports is bringing you the Stanley Cup playoffs. Murray trying to even up the shorthanded goal ledger. Larmer with some room. Push ice to Murray. He fires. Moves in front. DeVore. And a diving save by Fuhr.
Well, Savard's going to be upset of himself because Fuhrer really went down before Savard got a chance to shoot, and he shot it right into his pads. Savard making Fuhrer look pretty good. Let's take a look at Fuhrer's save here. He makes the original save. The rebound comes out. Now watch. He gets back up on his feet. He comes across. Now he's going down when he sees Savard with the puck, and Savard just shoveled it right into him.
So Fuhrer getting into the game. After two long shots have beaten him, he has now started 23 straight games for Edmonton. The last 12 games of the regular season and all 11 of the playoffs. 7 minutes, 50 seconds to go in this first period of play. 1:06 remain in the power play for the Blackhawks. Number 11, Mark Messier, who just moments ago scored his 6th playoff goal. Last year, he was the Conn Smythe winner as the most valuable player in the playoffs. Now the complaint to Ray Scapinello, the linesman, as Messier is asked to leave. Brand Fuhrer sets, looking for the Chicago shot off the face. And now Gretzky leaves the circle and comes back. Mysiak gets it out to Boyd. He has room. He shoots. And O'Callaghan does keep it in. Mysiak, cross ice to Murray. O'Callaghan. And it's blocked off of his teammate, Darryl Sutter. O'Callaghan. Murray looking back for Boyd. Darryl Sutter gets some room. And it is deflected into the crowd with 38 seconds left on the power play.
How much has Troy Murray been off the ice tonight so far? Not too much. Captain Darryl Sutter. I think when we're talking about some of these Blackhawk players and we talk about how much ice time they have had so much tonight, I think that we do understand one thing, though, that they've had 3 days of rest, and so in which case, early in the first period, they've got plenty of energy left.
Well,
but it's a long game.
After this one, they may need 3 more days of rest. Key figure for the Blackhawks, Bill Gardner, out. Knee surgery. And that puts more pressure on Troy Murray. Savard gets bumped. Now it is Gretzky. Can't get it out. Dennis Savard. Saved by Fuhrer. And Gretzky racing for it. Bannerman behind the net, watching for Gretzky. Unable to get that puck around him, but it is Bob Murray in on the scene and stands Gretzky up. Coffey turns around. His wrist shot. Saved. 6:45 to go in the first period of play. 2-2 the score. The Oilers and the Blackhawks and the teams at equal strength. Savard unable to make the move around Huddy. Krushelnicki bumped off the play by DuPont. Big Krushelnicki hard to remove from the puck. Here is Coffey. He overskates. As Edmonton keeps the puck in. Smothered by Bannerman.
Bannerman just saw that puck at the last second. Yari Curry didn't waste any time getting it away.
We have 6:17 to go in this first period. 2-2 is the score. Edmonton scored first. Chicago came back with 2, and then the Oilers have tied it up.
I don't think there's any question now that Coach Glenn Sather of the Oilers' game plan would have to center an awful lot around the inexperience on the blue line for the Blackhawks, and getting that puck either in reach is pretty inexperienced when it comes to one-on-one situations. And when Gretzky and Messier and Anderson utilize their speed, boy, they are tough on one-on-one.
And also, you have to focus in on Troy Murray. Will he wilt the longer this game goes? And did Gretzky take advantage of that? Darryl Sutter. He dumps it in. Savard, speaking of dump, goes down. 6 minutes left. As there's a stoppage in play from coast to coast in all 50 states. The Stanley Cup playoffs only on USA.
The Blackhawks both getting high sticking penalties. 14:04 is the time. As you look at Glenn Sather giving some instructions from behind the bench to the faceoff alignment,
which is in the Edmonton end zone.
Well, you say there's a little of Glenn Sather in Kevin McClellan. McClellan, who had 212 minutes in penalties this year, and goes to the box for the second time tonight. I think he's been on the ice for three shifts.
McClellan's been aggressive this season, Al, but he has not had a very productive season. They expected much more out of him. He played very well last year, his first year with the Oilers, and they were hoping he would continue. That hasn't been the case.
The Oilers won all three games in the regular season from the Blackhawks and then took the first two games of the playoffs. So the Blackhawks, who have been written off, bouncing back with a victory in Game 3. And now this one is tied at two apiece. Secord takes the puck for Chicago, starts out with a pass to Troy Murray. Whistle down, going over two arms.
You talk about Troy Murray and the fact that, yes, he has got a big assignment tonight. He's going to get lots of ice time, but when you realize the determination and stamina that Troy Murray has got within that body of his, I think he can do it, and I think he can do it quite easily. We can see that two-line pass taking place. That's why the faceoff is occurring just inside the Blackhawks' blue line, and Troy Murray will be going off for a rest, but because Wayne Gretzky is not on the ice right now.
22-year-old Troy Murray was a third-round draft pick. He helped lead North Dakota to the NCAA championship in 1982. 26 goal scorer for the Blackhawks, so he gives you a little more than defense out there. One of the real fine two-way players in the National Hockey League has come into his own this year. DuPont with Gretzky on his back. There may not be a long rest for Troy Murray. Lysiak comes out, crisscrossing with Secord, looking for Secord. He shoots, and it goes off the crossbar. Just caught the corner of the post. 5 minutes left in period one. Secord winding out again. Plays it back to his defense. Bob Murray. Secord looking to take the change and hit the bench. Did not know the puck was there. And out Charlie Huddy in a hurry. Long shot. And it's steered into the corner by Bannerman. Starting up, Bergevin with Olchek. One's 18 years old, one's 19 years old. Here's the 18-year-old, Olchek, smashed into the boards by Huddy. It is dug out by Troy Murray. And stolen by Curry. Leap pass for Gretzky, trying to sneak behind. And we have a whistle. An offside call. Let's go now to Al Chowdhury.
Al, you and Gary have been mentioning frequently the young Chicago defense and the problems that they're having.
First period, 2-2 the score. The Oilers and the Blackhawks hooked up here at Chicago Stadium. It has been a thriller in period one. Secord in front. Secord picks it up. Circles. It is O'Callaghan fighting for the puck. In deep, the defenseman. Secord has DuPont. DuPont wrist shot, and a weak one is steered aside by Fuhr. Winding up behind Gretzky, who is stopped by Secord. Secord would not allow Gretzky to get out. Troy Murray puts it in, and he is bumped by McClellan. Gary Curry on the right wing. Off the boards for Gretzky, who can't hold on. It is taken by Sutter. Sutter moving in, and he is sandwiched by two of the Edmonton Oilers. Bergevin swings and misses off the boards as the puck is floated back to center. Bergevin for the Blackhawks. Leap pass to Sutter, scored his 10th playoff goal tonight. We have 3 minutes and 5 seconds to go in the first period. Bob Murray wraps it off the boards. It is picked up by Savard. Savard through the legs. Savard walks in. Scores!
But Steve Larmer and Savard have worked so well together. The
soon as Larmer got that puck, he knew exactly what he was going to do with it. Most people would think that he would have shot. No way. He puts it right back on the stick of his center iceman, Dennis Savard.
It is 3-2 in favor of the Blackhawks. Savard, Nureyev on ice. And against the Hawks, the one-goal lead, but Edmonton comes back. Score! Kozar breaks through. And just as quickly as the Blackhawks take the lead, Edmonton bounces back and ties it at 3.
What a seesaw battle we've got going here at the stadium. No sooner does one team score than it's the next team's turn. And here goes Kozar. You can see that he had some pretty good coverage on him by number 26, Rick Patterson, for the Blackhawks, but not good enough coverage. Nice little pass by number 9, Glenn Anderson, over to Pozar, and Pozar kind of took that puck right in midair, put it on the blade of his stick, and just flipped it up and over on his backhand, over top of Murray Bannerman.
Well, Pozar, who put Bill Gardner out of commission the other night, and then here in Chicago with a touch of class visiting Gardner at the hospital, and here he is, only the 6th playoff game he's played, his second goal, both against Chicago. He scored in game number 3. So Kozar ties it up. 2 minutes, 20 seconds still remaining in a shootout. And here comes Edmonton looking for more. Messier drops it. Kozar again. And the rebound is cleared away by Chicago. Rick Patterson with some speed. Looking for help. Lysiak into the corner he goes. Right in front he has Frazier. Bergevin pulls the trigger and it just slides by. Bob Murray, the shot is pure. Is still out of his cage and he is hurt.
I think Fuhr did the splits, and when he went down, I got a feeling that something very wrong with Grant Fuhr right now.
We will return to the Chicago Stadium. A shootout with a minute 51 to go in the first. 3-3 to score.
And referee Ron Hogarth stopped play.
Fuhr has played all but 5 minutes in the Edmonton's 11 playoff games. And he has an all-star goalie, another all-star goalie, sitting on the bench behind him at Andy Moog.
And I don't think Glenn Frazier would think twice about going to Andy Moog either, because he's got lots of confidence in Moog's abilities. But with Grant Fuhr having played so well this year in playoffs, he's got to pretty well stick with the hot goaltender, and Grant Fuhr has won games for this Edmonton team.
All right, to catch up on goals, Savard scored his 8th at 17:05 from Larmer and Bergevin, and 15 seconds later, Yaroslav Kuzar from Glenn Anderson at 17:20. Well, game 3 was a goaltender's night. This so far is a goaltender's nightmare. 3 goals has been scored on each of them.
I'd be a little worried about the Blackhawks right now opening up too much against this Oilers team.
These are the 2 highest scoring teams in the playoffs. Right in front! Score! Frazier! Wonderful!
He picks it up, takes one look towards the net, and sees that Frazier was moving in on that left wing position. Nice tap in by Frazier, and the Blackhawks once again have the lead. Let's see if they can hang on to it this time for the remainder of this first period at least.
So Curt Frazier, who is playing with badly bruised ribs that is still bothering him, scores his 6th playoff goal, his first goal in this series against Edmonton. And who would have expected this tonight? 4-3. In the first period, Chicago leads. Olczyk and Troy Murray get the assist at 18-17. Lysiak spinning with Vogel and Aho. And a penalty coming up to the Oilers.
Well, the Blackhawks are smart right now just to hold their cool. The Oilers take the penalty box. And that's exactly what Lee Foldrum is doing right now. Going to that penalty box, the Blackhawks will be on the power play.
Are the Edmonton Oilers unraveling here in the first period?
I don't know, Al. I think they play so many games like this during the course of the regular season that this is just more or less a typical hockey game for them.
Holderman goes off for 2 minutes. We have a minute 13 left in this first, which has been wall-to-wall action. 4-3, the Blackhawks on their home ice lead, looking to tie this series up. Secord digging at the puck, but it is sealed in there by Hunter with 1 minute to go in this first period.
You had mentioned Kurt Fraser playing a little bit injured right now and playing with a flap jacket to really protect those bruised ribs of his, and he's been able to continue to play even with that injury and play pretty well, I might add. He's a good solid winger going up and down the boards, and tonight he put the puck in the net.
Hoagland's penalty came at 18:47 for slashing. As the Blackhawks set it up, Bob Murray rushes to the red line and drills it in. Then Wilson. It is Savoy. Back to Wilson. He fires. Rebound. Lomer gets it out to Murray. Puts it across to Wilson. Savoy has it on his stick. Looking for a seam. Save. Rebound. Score! Decoy!
Position in front of that net, trying to do some damage. Lee Foldrum, number two, the defenseman, is trying to cover Al Secord, just cover his stick. He wasn't quite quick enough. Secord really moved fast when that puck came out. He put it right by Grant Fuhrer.
And Al Secord finally breaks the ice. That's his first goal in this series. 5-3 in favor of Chicago. The power play goal, and now just 15 seconds left.
I wouldn't be surprised if you see Andy Moog come in to the start of the second period. Fuhrer may not be 100% healthy out there right now on the ice.
Well, perhaps the indicator, the first two goals that beat him, the crowd standing with 2 seconds, 1 second to go. It will be a standing ovation for the Blackhawks when they come off the ice. Secord from Savard and Ben Wilson at 19:35 to make it 5-3. Fuhrer had given up 9 goals in the first 3 games. He has given up 5 goals here in the first period. Pandemonium in the Chicago Stadium as the disappointed Oilers go off the ice, and the Blackhawks hearing the cheers of this standing only room only crowd. Doug Wilson, the defenseman of the Chicago Blackhawks, who is in his civilian clothes tonight, will be joining Al Troutman. This is action. The Blackhawks 5 and the Oilers 3. You have some time? Let's look at the scoring summary. Gretzky started it out at 2:52. Darryl Sutter then scored his 10th playoff goal. That's shorthanded. Ed Olczyk at 9:50 made it 2-1 Chicago. Mark Messier, just a little over a minute later, tied it up. Then Dennis Savard at 17:05 made it 3-2 to Chicago. Kuzar, 15 seconds later, tied it up at 3-3. Kurt Frazier made it 4-3 at 18:17. And Al Secord, a power play goal, closed the scoring at 19:35. Those last 4 goals coming in a span of 2.5 minutes as the Blackhawks take the lead over the Oilers. And you know, Gary, in game number 3, there are many people who were very surprised when the Blackhawks jumped on Edmonton for 5 goals to win it 5-2. They've done it here in the first period.
I couldn't be more surprised at the fact that the Chicago Blackhawks have scored 5 goals. You can expect to see an Edmonton Oilers team from time to time score that many goals in a period, but the Chicago team are really hustling out there. I think they have caught the Edmonton Oilers once again by surprise, and the word hustle really sticks in mind because of that exact characteristic of the Chicago Blackhawks right now. Hustle, sheer determination, and I tend to think, though, the Blackhawks
are getting into a wide-open hockey game. How else can you describe a 5-3 first period?
Well, you have said in the past that the biggest mistake for a team is to get into a wide-open hockey game against Edmonton. So why have they been successful?
Well, first of all, I think they've been successful because, again, of determination of putting that puck in the net. Dennis Savard, one of the many Blackhawks that scored in that first period of play, he really was going out there, Alan. Just a nice move between Dennis Savard and Steve Larmer, and boy, those two players really combined on a beautiful goal, and I think that you can say that the Blackhawks are capable of doing that.
All right, let's take a look at that goal. No question of the eighth, the most beautiful and spectacular of that first period.
One thing, when Dennis Savard drops that puck to Steve Larmer, I think that Steve Larmer, unlike a lot of other players who might have shot in that situation, has got such excellent hands. He can just feed beautiful passes back to Dennis Savard. And Steve Larmer probably doesn't get the recognition that sometimes he deserves, because playing with Dennis Savard, Savard is such a beautiful player to watch. He catches your eye, but it takes a great right winger to play give and go with Dennis Savard and set him up in a lot of those situations, and Larmer did exactly that on that one.
Edmonton trailing 5-3. Are they trailing by two in this kind of a game because of the Chicago Blackhawks or because of the Edmonton Oilers?
I think there's a combination of both. First of all, you can't take anything away from the Chicago Blackhawks. They are really playing well out there. But Grant Fuhr really was questionable on some of those goals, and it appears as though Grant Fuhr is going to stay in the net for the second period. And I had speculated that maybe we would see Andy Moog between the pipes for the Oilers.
And you hear the thunderous ovation from the crowd as the Chicago Blackhawks, now the darlings of this city, make their way onto the ice. After the first two games in Edmonton, the Blackhawks, by most of the hockey following, completely written off in the playoff series, written off perhaps even in four games. They were outscored 18-5 in the two games in Edmonton. Showed tremendous heart in game number three, playing with key injuries and winning 5-2. Dennis Savard said, Gary, that's the gutsiest performance he's ever seen. Well, it may have been even surpassed in period number one here tonight.
Al, I think Doug Wilson said something that is very important as well when you look at the Chicago Blackhawks team, is that, of course, they have to have character in order to come back after being beaten pretty badly in those two games in Edmonton. And when you look at players like Al Secord and Troy Murray out there, and not to mention, of course, the fact of what Dennis Savard can do, but when you look at the real gutsy leaders of this Chicago Blackhawks team, no question, the Daryl Sutters and the Troy Murray's and the Ed Olczyk, even though this is his first year, yes, Ed Olczyk is a gutsy leader. And, of course, Murray Bannerman between the pipes. Really have to look at the inspiration quality of this Chicago Blackhawks team and say, well, it's not right from off yet, folks, because after three games and one period, we have seen that the Blackhawks are by no means out of it.
And you know, Grant Fuhr had to tell Glenn Sather he wanted to stay in there. Very shaky, to say the least, in the first 20 minutes. Blackhawks outshot Edmonton 13-12. Also keep in mind, Andy Moog is dressed, but he is still having problems with the knees that he injured back on March 4th. He has not played a whole game since that time. He came in for 5 minutes in one game in the playoffs, a few just to get a little ice time. So there's a question that he may not be completely ready, but if that's true, then why would he even dress on the bench? Here's Curry overskating as he brings it in. Curry slaps at the puck. Semenko dinks it out. Watched by O'Callaghan. Gretzky hovering in front. And it's intercepted and cleared on the stick of Olczyk, who finally scored here tonight after a five-game drought. Melnick back the other way as Ben Wilson being charged by Semenko. Those two in an altercation early in the game within the first 2 minutes. And here goes the fight. Olczyk, number 16 for the Blackhawks, and Melnick, number 28 for Edmonton.
For a young player, Ed Olczyk handled himself pretty well out there. That all started originally and in front of the penalty box when Olczyk and Melnick collided, and then it continued on out into the center ice area.
You're watching the Stanley Cup playoffs only on USA Sports. We're at the Chicago Stadium.
In this second period, I think the Oilers have got a little bit more intensity going for them.
Well, they're finding out a funny thing happen on the way to the Stanley Cup Finals. They are not waltzing in. After sweeping Winnipeg in four games, sweeping Los Angeles in the first round in three, and winning the first two games against Chicago. But now the Blackhawks putting up a wall here in Chicago. Bannerman comes out, uses the stick. Lysiak scrapping with Anderson, kicking at the puck. Messier behind the net. And Lysiak on his back, able to poke check that puck away. Lysiak chasing. Kozar right in front. Anderson and DuPont struggle with one another. And now it is Coffey getting the inside track on Patterson. And loses to Lysiak. And Chicago clears it out. Picked up by Patterson. Patterson, he goes in. And Fuhr got a piece of that with his elbow. Fuhr kicks that one out. Winds deep in his own zone, right on the stick of Kozar. Kozar over the blue line. Kozar still with the puck. And he is nailed in the boards by Murray. Kozar becoming a thorn in the side of the Blackhawks. And a two-line pass is called.
Chicago Blackhawks playing with some real discipline in their own end zone. On that last shift, the Edmonton Oilers had possession of the puck in the Blackhawk end zone for about 40 seconds, but yet they had no dangerous scoring opportunities, and that was because of the fact that Ben Wilson and the rest of the Blackhawks out on the ice were really maintaining their positioning. That's something that obviously Bob Pulford has gotten across to this team, that you're not going to beat the Edmonton Oilers by running around in your own end zone. Stick to playing your position, each man responsible for his own job out there.
These Blackhawks defeated the Detroit Red Wings in the first series 3-0, scored 23 goals in those three games to set an NHL playoff record for most goals in a three-game series, then went on to slug it out with Minnesota, winning in six those last three games going to overtime. And now against Edmonton, these are the two highest scoring teams in the playoffs. They're both averaging just under six goals a game, and certainly online here tonight. The pattern remains. The final score tonight will be 15-9. Lindstrom shot. And we have a whistle. And another penalty to Kevin McClellan. He's batting 750. He's been on the ice four times. Penalized three of those. The score, Chicago 5, Edmonton 3. We'll be right back.
Once again is Kevin McClellan. 2 minutes behind. Ticking this time. 2:10 is the time.
The Blackhawks 1-for-2 on the power play. Secord's power play goal with 25 seconds left in the first period was the first power play goal in the series by the Hawks in 11 attempts. And now the danger against Edmonton, the best team in the NHL for shorthanded goals. They scored 25 of those during the regular season. 11 by Gretzky. Savard plays it back. And now Chicago on the rush. Randy Boyd shoots it in. A tricky hop. Boyd stays with it. Bob Murray in pursuit. Dennis Savard. Side of the net goes to Secord. Back to Savard, who spreads the Oilers out. Cross ice. Lahmer was poised and ready to pull that trigger. Now he has some room. Secord using the body, but poked away nicely by Lowe. Curry gets pushed around. Savard skips around Fogelin. Lowe slaps it the other way. Curry unable to keep it in. A minute to go on the power play. The Blackhawks really feel the pressure at home. The crowd, as you have found out by now, very noisy, and they have a tendency to really get on the Hawks on the power play when it doesn't click. So the Hawks' power play effort is better on the road than at home. 40 seconds to go in the power play for Chicago. And it is Bob Murray, the long pass for Savard, and it goes into the Chicago bench, so it is whistled down with 37 seconds left on the man advantage for Chicago. The Quebec Nordiques have done it 5-3 over the Flyers at the Spectrum. That snaps the Philadelphia win streak at the Spectrum, 21 straight games, and it evens the series at two games apiece, heading to Quebec for game number two on Tuesday night.
Well, I think the Philadelphia Flyers are really hurting without Brad McCrimmon on defense, and of course without Tim Kerr and Dave Poulin up front. They are really suffering from the injuries.
Well, actually, he goes to Quebec for game five Tuesday night. All mounted at two games apiece. We have 4 minutes gone by in this second period in Chicago. With the Blackhawks trying to even this series at two games apiece. Offside call against Chicago. 21 seconds left in the power play.
Interesting, the combination with it out there. He feels his club is much better on the attack than they are defending.
Gretzky scoring a goal here tonight. The first one, if you can remember that far back. But in these two games, Gary, Gretzky has looked like a mere mortal. Matter of fact, if you didn't know who Gretzky was or which team he was on, you would think Dennis Savard was Gretzky, the guy you've been hearing so much about. The penalty is over. The team's at equal strength, and the faceoff will come to the right of Grant Fuhr.
Well, we'll take a moment right now to remind you that this game is authorized under television rights granted by the National Hockey League. It's intended solely for the private, non-commercial use of our audience. Any publication, reproduction, retransmission, or other use of the pictures, descriptions, and accounts of this game without the express written consent of the National Hockey League is strictly prohibited.
Jack O'Callaghan, who grew up in the Boston area, and as a kid used to go to the Boston Garden and watch Bobby Orr, and lately he's been doing his Bobby Orr impression. He had a goal and assist in game three and another assist here tonight.
He's really been carrying a lot of weight back on that Chicago Blackhawk blue line, and he's responded very well for it. He has got some pretty good qualities about him. Right now, Ron Hogarth on the ice doing a lot of pushing players back to the Chicago bench. He just said, you've had your last line change and you're not going to take too much of an advantage of that opportunity.
Bob Pulford playing a little possum there, what? He says.
Now, Pulford is saying that Al Secord was on the ice. He came off. You told me to get the guys back on the ice. And so, oh, out comes Al Secord again, but
well,
he's not going to stay.
Pulford also may be buying some time for his tired club, who is playing short men, key men, Doug Wilson and Keith Brown on defense, Bill Gardner up front. 15:46 left in the second period. 5-3, the Blackhawks lead. And more of a delay as Dennis Savard steps in against Mark Messier. Charlie Huddy plays it to Coffey, who has really been kept under wraps in these two games. Lumley, number eight, he collides with Sutter as the boards slam by the two players and Ron Hogarth calling a penalty. And now it is Sutter and Lumley. Lumley gets in the way, and now Lumley goes down. Gets hit in the face. There was a sucker punch by Lumley, the right to Darryl Sutter.
I think Lumley got one in return then. Lumley came out in the ice, and there wasn't much question about the fact that he was going to stir something up.
For our local systems, we'll pause now. It's the Stanley Cup Playoffs live, only on USA Sports.
Sutter, and then that just continued all the way around behind the net and then almost out to the blue line, and it all started with the collision with Sutter pinning Lumley up against the boards, and then doing a little bit of pushing. It seemed very harmless at the time, but after that, sparks flew.
Lumley in the playoff series had taken a headfirst shot into the boards earlier. He has only played four games coming into this one, but still refuses to wear a helmet. As the penalties are now assessed,
well, you can see on the scoreboard here that Darryl Sutter has got a double minor for roughing, and that Lumley and
Krusinski
both have roughing penalties, all occurring at 4:32 in this second period.
So the teams will remain right now. Well, actually, Edmonton loses a man on this deal. But then Edmonton will be up a man as Savard steps in. 4-on-3 for the Blackhawks, leading by two goals. Savard fires, and it's off a skate. The skate of Kevin Lowe and into the crowd. So while the two Oilers right now sit out their penalty, the Blackhawks have the man advantage. But when they come back, Sutter will still have 2 minutes left.
And then it will be the Oilers' opportunity on the power play. Dennis Savard out there taking the face-off, coming up in the Oilers' end zone. Let's watch this shot coming from way out. You'd almost think that the Chicago Blackhawks are thinking a little bit about shooting from a long distance on Grant Fuhr. It paid off a couple of times in the first period, so why not try it again?
Savard with a goal and assist tonight. That gives him 24 points in the playoffs, two shy of Gretzky, who leads. And Savard is now 1 point shy of the Chicago all-time playoff record, which is held by Bobby Hull, 25 points. 5 minutes into the second period. After eight goals in that first period, no scoring here in the second. Savard takes it in, and the poke check, and the Blackhawks have to come back. Not for long. Here's Savard in front. Hits the post. Troy Murray keeps it alive. Bob Murray spreading the Oilers out. Savard has it on the stick again. The magician looking to go to work. Troy Murray gets it clear into the corner. Intercepted by Coffey, and he's going to go with it. Coffey along with Curry. And the poke check by Troy Murray, who's all over the place.
Troy Murray was trying to get that diagonal pass over to the right wing to Steve Larmer. Just didn't work.
Murray to Larmer. Teeing it up. Bob Murray keeps it in. Steve Larmer, 46-goal scorer this year. Bob Murray takes a look in front. Savard takes Curry into the corner. Sets up Murray. Larmer. Cross ice Savard. And Curry got a piece of that one, and it deflects high into the crowd. 23 seconds left in the Chicago power play.
Some really nice passing by the Blackhawks. Yari Curry anticipated that pass beautifully, just tipped it off as Dennis Savard was trying to shoot. Let's watch some of the action again. And first of all, Dennis Savard, look how close he comes. Fuhr just got a piece of it. It hits the post. But the Blackhawks really had some good opportunities here. Again, some excellent passing, and this one right on Dennis Savard's stick as we see it from another angle. And watch. You can see that puck and how close it came to giving these Blackhawks a 6-3 lead.
Ben Wilson shovels across to O'Callaghan. Crowd wants him to shoot. Instead goes back to Wilson. And it deflects wide. 12 seconds left on the power play for Chicago. Then Edmonton will have their turn on the power play for the next 2 minutes. 5-3, the Blackhawks lead, trying to even this series at 2 games apiece. And now, it's Edmonton on the power play. Lowe rounds the net. Comes to center and slaps it in. Bannerman with Chris Omiski right on him, and Bannerman gets rid of it. Right out of the stick of Gretzky. Gretzky off the skate of Wilson. The shot from the point, and it goes wide. Huddy to Messier. Messier brings it out at the point. Kuchelniski walks in. Backhand wide. Recovered by Coffey. Gretzky. Stick handling in front. O'Callaghan gets in the way. Lunsick comes in for Chicago. Gretzky hemming it up along the boards. Lunsick goes down. As the puck is still free, now it is whistled.
Well, just once again, a lot of determination by the Blackhawks, and that's really what penalty killing is all about. Some sheer determination, some good anticipation, cutting off those angles of pass, and of course winning the battles along the boards on one-on-one situations, and that's what caused this little discussion right now between these two teams, and the puck is along the boards in the fight for it.
And now 17,000 voices also getting on Wayne Gretzky, who is tied up by Steve Lunsick. The Hawks will try to annoy Gretzky in any fashion. 12 and a half minutes left in the second period.
Well, you can see as we were talking, Steve Lunsick doing some excellent work just hanging on to that puck. Wayne Gretzky trying to get a hold of the puck, and instead Steve Lunsick gets a hold of Wayne Gretzky, puts him up against the boards, and then we get a stoppage of play, and that's when the discussion broke out.
Lunsick was picked by the Blackhawks in the 1980 draft when they selected Dennis Savard Lutzik and Troy Murray on the third round, and Steve Larmer on the sixth round.
Not a bad draft.
Perhaps little did they know at the time. They knew they had Dennis Savard, but the other three have really come through. Messier with some nifty moves to get into the zone. And there is Lutzik. And there is Troy Murray. 39 seconds remain, and the penalty to Sutter. Winding out now is Coffey. He has not had much ice to work. As the Hawks will try to crowd Coffey as much as they can. Coffey goes back for it. He is the fifth leading scorer in the playoffs with 18 points. And it is Anderson putting on the speed. Trying to wind around DuPont. Coffey from the point. Saved by Bannerman. With Anderson trying to tip at it in front.
One of the youngsters on the blue line, Jerome DuPont, doing an excellent job in front. And Bannerman making the save. Paul Coffey, boy, can he move out there. He may have a bad foot, but it sure doesn't show. Coffey just wheeling, but the Blackhawks watching him very closely tonight. Coffey, when he gets some open ice, you see a couple of Blackhawks there, very quiet Bannerman.
11 and a half minutes to go in this second period. Sutter comes back on the ice, and the teams are at equal strength. 5-3. The Hawks lead the Oilers. And a two-line pass against Chicago. So we'll have the faceoff inside the Blackhawks blue line.
Well, you'd like to package that speed between Paul Coffey. You look at that injured right foot. You cannot tell that it is injured, and you can't tell by the way that Paul Coffey is skating out there tonight, but his laces are very, very loose at the bottom rungs of his skate, and that just takes a little bit of the pressure off of the foot, but he was bound and determined he was going to play tonight. Paul Coffey's mother has flown in from Toronto for the game tonight, and that even made him more determined to play and play well.
Kevin Lowe backhands it out to center ice. Then Wilson plays it ahead. Here is Lowe with Lumley and Hunter and McClellan, the checking line on for Edmonton. As Sather perhaps trying to stir things up. After these two teams combined on 8 goals in that first period, which is one shy of the all-time playoff record, there's been no scoring here in the second period. The place to stay for exclusive coverage of the Stanley Cup playoffs is only on USA Sports. That indeed they are alive after losing the first two games. And you heard Doug Wilson talking to Al Chodwig in between periods saying that he hopes he can come back for Game 5 Tuesday night in Edmonton. What a boost that would be to Chicago. They lose so much defensively and offensively. And Bannerman gobbles that one up. I'd watch the commotion in front. Again, this is the line for Edmonton that certainly has the capability of stirring things up with McClellan out there, Big Crucial Niski, and Dave Lumley.
But it seems that every stoppage in play, players are gathering together and having some discussions. Big Crucial Niski now going to the bench. Ben Wilson, without question, getting a lot of ice time. And as I've mentioned before about Ben Wilson, when he is of mind to play, with the determination and the abilities that he has been given, then he can really be an effective player out there. And Wilson's problem has been consistency in the past. Well, we'll look at the Edmonton Oilers doing a little bit of dumping and chasing, going after that puck, and Murray Bannerman making sure just by slowing the game down.
Lumley hustles after it, and it's cleared to center ice.
Speaking about slowing the game down, remember in Game 3 here in Chicago, that's exactly what the Blackhawks did in the latter part of the second period. They tried to slow the game down, and they did so almost to a snail's pace there.
Well, slowed down there for Darryl Sutter. McClellan, long pass for Lumley, and he bats it in, but an offside call against the Oilers. Back in 79, it was the
more angry. Some pretty good checks being handed out, and this was one of them. Sutter missed the pass, and then got a good stiff shoulder from Leif Oglis.
Sutter earlier tonight scored his 10th playoff goal to lead the Blackhawks in that category. Curry with 11 leads Edmonton. This is Lindstrom heading in. This has been a very quiet period for Murray Bannerman. It is Dennis Savard riding Napier into the boards. Krushelnicki bats it in front. Lindstrom scores! And it is 5-4. So the Oilers, with Wayne Gretzky leading the cheering from the bench.
That takes some heat off of Wayne Gretzky and Yuri Curry when players like Billy Lindstrom start scoring. Watch how this play develops. Lindstrom, just in the middle of your screen, gets a shot away and from a fair distance out, that's right out in the middle of the slot at the hash mark, and he just left that puck go, beating Murray Bannerman. Ben Wilson, number 23, the defenseman for the Blackhawks, tried to get to Willie Lindstrom, but not in time. Lindstrom gets the shot away.
Well, perhaps Bannerman needs more action. Fell asleep there. Lindstrom, not a good shot, right through his legs, as Lindstrom scores just his second playoff goal. And now the Oilers one goal behind. It is Napier who puts it in, as Glenn Sather stays out there with his line of Lindstrom, Napier, and Krushelnicki. Yaremchuk making his first appearance on the ice, number 15 for Chicago. Krushelnicki and Napier get the assist on Lindstrom's goal at 10:20 of the second period. 5-4, Chicago leads. Number 31 on the ice. Now here's Napier with the steal. Here's number 31 for the Blackhawks. Dan Frawley making his first appearance. He is dressed with the absence of Bill Gardner, who underwent knee surgery for torn ligaments after that bad hit in game number 3. Violento Systems will pause now. You're watching the Stanley Cup playoffs live on USA.
Something going. He was hitting and once again flying.
Curry the long shot, and what a bullet off the pads of Bannerman. Honey, the shot is smothered, and it appears now as if the Blackhawks were settling to defend that two-goal lead. Olchek racing with Coffey. Olchek spinning around the net as Honey comes back to knock it away. And it is Curry winding out for the Oilers. Curry back to Gretzky, and a penalty coming up on Edmonton as Wayne Gretzky heads right to the penalty box.
Well, Gretzky got caught. This time his shadow was shadowing a little bit too much. Gretzky pulled him out.
We hope you're enjoying the Stanley Cup playoffs here on USA.
He gets a hooking penalty. 11:59 was the time, and we will see exactly why he gets sent to the penalty box. Not much question about it, is there?
Now, well, down his shadow, number 19, Troy Murray. Me and my shadow, one way to get rid of him. One thing Gretzky did say after being shut out the other night, gave Murray credit, said that at least he plays an honest game. Very clean in what he was doing. Not the case with many players who try to shadow and stop Gretzky. Gretzky had only 52 minutes in penalties during the season, and he gets one here. A bouncer on Fuhrer takes it on the one hop. Looked like a shortstop there, taking the high hopper.
Well, he got his body in front of it. That is another good sign of a shortstop.
Shortstop playing with a first baseman's mitt. So Grant Fuhrer has not been beaten, not really tested that much here in the second period after giving up 5 in the first. And now the Blackhawks have the faceoff in the Edmonton zone on the power play. Secor goes cross ice. Back to Bob Murray. Larmer. And he throws it away as Hunter clears it down.
The Blackhawks really look to try and set up that diagonal pass either to Dennis Savard or to Steve Larmer. And Larmer, being on the right-hand side and a left-hand shooter, can get an excellent shot away when he gets the puck.
And the Blackhawks will have to reorganize. 7 minutes and 10 seconds left in the second period. The Oilers have moved to within one. 5-4 is the score. Larmer has some room. He goes in. Score!
Steve Larmer cannot believe how much room he had. Right down the middle of the ice goes Steve Larmer.
Where were the Edmonton defensemen? Well, you'll have to ask number 21 Randy Gregg and number 28 Larry Melnick. They got crisscrossed, and boy, did they look bad on that one. Steve Armour's the wrong guy to have possession of the puck, and you get fouled up on defense when you're the opposition.
So the Blackhawks fans go wild once more. The 10th goal of this game, six of them by Chicago, four by the Oilers. And the Blackhawks bounce back after Edmonton scores to move to within one and again takes that two-goal lead. A power play goal, the second one of the night for Chicago, which had not scored a power play goal in this series. Boyd gets the assist at 12:53. Larmer scores his seventh of the playoffs. Napier. And what a big goal for the Blackhawks, because it appeared as if Edmonton was now stealing the play. Napier from the blue line, floats it in, and Bannerman has that one beaten, but it was off goal.
And we think that the Blackhawks may have learned their lesson. Whenever they score, they've got to try twice as hard, because this Edmonton team has lots of character, and they really come back at you.
Minutes and 22 seconds left in this second period.
Like coffee to get into a fight. But he started wailing away, and I am not sure which Blackhawk it is underneath of Ray Scampanello, the linesman, and Gerard Gauthier. We will no doubt learn in a second or so, or maybe a minute or so.
Well, it may be getting a little steam, the frustration. There's some hot coffee. And we'll see exactly who he was engaged with.
Well, it was number 29, Steve Ludzik, that he was involved in it with.
Well, we hope you're enjoying this one, the Stanley Cup playoffs, right here on USA.
I'm playing in the standout here right now. Ludzik and Coffey both getting fighting penalties. 13:38 is the time.
Certainly not skating in the sand. 6-4. The Blackhawks on their home ice leading the Edmonton Oilers. Bouncing back in this series. 6 minutes and 20 seconds to go. The long shot by DuPont here in this second period. It is Messier hustling out. Shoots it ahead. Bannerman leaves it go. Lumley hustling for the Oilers. Messier misses the check. It goes one-on-one with the glass. Jamming along the board. Secord now with some extra work against 6'4" Randy Gregg.
Well, you know one thing. You know that Al Secord is very capable in the fighting department, but he wants to stay on the ice right now, as does number 11 Mark Messier. Messier and Secord have been out against each other for all of Game 3 practically, and for most of Game 4 here in Chicago. Messier has been lined up against Tom Hysiak, and of course Secord over on the left wing side. Let's take a look at some of the action that resulted in the stoppage of play, and you could see that Tom Hysiak, he's been getting into the hitting as well. That was Mark Messier, who he has been watching very closely in Chicago's end zone.
Hysiak and Messier square off for the faceoff. Lumley getting the stick up along with the on the far side DuPont, and they are separated by the linesman. Lumley has a few extra words pointing to his stick, I believe, and they line up again. The shot from the goal as Murray Bannerman looks out on the faceoff. And Edmonton has to turn around, come all the way back. And it's an icing, so we'll go deeper into the Chicago end. That has been the story the last two games. The Blackhawks still remember the embarrassment of game number one when they were beaten 11-2. And now they've piled up six goals in two periods. Secord bumping as he winds his way through. It looks like a pinball in the pinball machine. A nice move by Messier. He has Pozar in front, but DuPont comes back to sweep it away for Chicago. Melnick hit from behind by Lysiak. And Lumley drills it in. 5:45
5 minutes, 10 seconds left in this second period. It is Murray carrying it out to center ice. And Kevin Lowe, with all the room in the world now, as Chicago makes a line change. Carrying is Curry. He's smothered. Curry and Wilson bump. Curry digging for the puck. Gets it out, but O'Callaghan is there. Frazier clears. And here's Olchek with low back. He fires. Kick save by Fuhr. Frazier right on top of it. He shoots it across the crease. O'Callaghan blocked, and now a break for Edmonton with Gretzky leading it. He goes back to Curry. He fires, and a save by Bannerman, who gets everything behind that bullet shot. Olchek ties up Gretzky. And Pozar plays it cross ice. Gretzky shadowed by Olchek. He goes sliding into the boards. And now it is Frazier who puts the stick to the back of Huddy. Pozar goes in. And an offside call against Edmonton.
The frustration mounts for Wayne Gretzky and his line mate, Wayne Gretzky, if it's not Troy Murray, number 19, and it's number 16 at Olchek. And Olchek just stays with his man. Remember the very bad mistake by a Chicago Blackhawk player in the first period when Jerome DuPont did not get all of Wayne Gretzky, and as a result, he scored. Well, from that point onwards, the Blackhawks have been making a point of getting the whole Gretzky body and not just a piece of it.
And Olchek, who says that he patterns his game after that of the Islanders' John Tinelli, and was really getting away from that. That's why one reason he was slumping. It was affecting his whole game, even offensively. Fuhr looking for help. And the Blackhawk down, Sutter right in front of him, but he held the puck too long.
I couldn't think of a better player for Ed Olchek to pattern himself after.
Now still two goals behind. In the first three games against the Blackhawks, he had given up a total of 9 goals. He's allowed 6 in this game, 5 in the first period. 3.5 minutes to go as Pushelniski's lead pass goes out to Lindstrom. Warmer, the back pass to Savard. Right out of the stick of DuPont. Long shot, and it is gobbled up by Fuhr.
Now Fuhr's making sure on those long shots now, and he's not giving away that puck easily. He's going to take the stoppage and play. When Fuhr went down in the first period and was revived really with some smelling salts, I don't know if I've ever seen a player take as many sniffs of the smelling salts as Grant Fuhr did.
Waits his turn. Lindstrom across. Gorodinsky has played only 33 minutes. Bannerman, like Fuhr, has gone most of the way. Dal Sutter unable to cut in. Lindstrom overskates. Savard putting on the moves. He has O'Callaghan, but he does a 360, and his shot is deflected into the crowd.
Well, it's important for Dennis Savard's line when they are out there playing against Edmonton's combinations, the variety of ones they have had, either the third or fourth line, that they at least keep that line off the scoreboard. And that has not necessarily been the case in tonight's game. Dennis Savard right now going to the bench, but Savard's task has been to score. And if you're going to play your best line against the other team's third or fourth line, you've got to come out plus. Let's watch some of those moves by Dennis Savard. He's got some great abilities. He usually goes down that left wing side, puts on the brakes, and then tries to control the play and set it up from there. He is a great player. That time it didn't work, however.
Edmonton going in offside. In this series, you are seeing probably the two most spectacular offensive players, what they can do alone with the puck in Gretzky versus Dennis Savard. And they are number one and two in scoring in the playoffs.
Well, unfortunately for Wayne Gretzky, he's not been able to put on much of a demonstration of his abilities. If you look at Al Secord getting ready for the faceoff, of course, Gretzky's mobility has been the plus to the Chicago Blackhawks, and Troy Murray's continuing to do an excellent job on Gretzky.
Mark Messier winding it up, ahead to Anderson. 3 men back for the Blackhawks as Secord puts the body into Messier. The puck sealed in there, and we'll have a face-off now in the Chicago end. 2 minutes, 37 seconds left in the second period.
Now, some of the young Chicago defensemen that we've talked a lot about tonight, and you heard Doug Wilson say that Bob Pulford just continues to go with those players, even out of pressure in the playoffs. And pressure is something that Mark Messier knows an awful lot about.
Messier will take the faceoff. And it is cleared all the way down. And another icing. Well, when Chicago had the 5-3 lead heading into the second period, Gary, it appeared as if they may be trying to sit on it a little bit.
Tremendous abilities, not only defensively, but especially in the offensive department. And so there's no reason the Blackhawks can't play a two-way game. Get two men in on top of the Oilers, force them to give up that puck in their own end zone, but keep that third man back helping out your defenseman so you don't get caught with any less than three of your own men back behind your own red line.
And it is shot down. Fuhr comes out. Patterson with Lysiak doing some stick work. Lysiak still digging for it with Anderson. Curry races. DuPont slaps at it and keeps it in as the crowd responds. We come now to 2 minutes remaining. Messier unable to get room, but Curry picks it up in the slot, right into the stomach of Bannerman. Anderson perched on the doorstep looking for any garbage.
I think Bob Murray might be hurt. He is down on the ice and bleeding. And after that last play, when Anderson came rushing in on Bannerman, then Murray, I think, may have received a stick in the face. That is not good news for the Blackhawks. On the bridge of his nose, I think Bob Murray has received a cut. Hope it is just on the bridge of his nose and not around his eye.
Jack O'Callaghan looking in.
You can see how the sticks were really getting up here. Now let's watch Murray Bannerman. He had off to the left and he had lots of traffic in front of him, but Bob Murray was already, I think, cut at that time. But there was no stick that was apparent in the area of Bob Murray's face when he went down. And after Anderson had come in, so it must have happened before.
Keep an eye on number six, Bob Murray, and the white. The shot goes in on Bannerman. Now watch closely. Where does he get it?
No, it was definitely Glenn Anderson's stick that caught Bob Murray.
And he is now being let off by his teammates. Al Secord and Jack O'Callaghan, another injury, and another fallen Blackhawk.
Boy, oh boy, the defense has really been riddled for the Blackhawks. When you look at the Blackhawks' defense and ask anybody the question, who are the three most mobile defensemen of the Chicago Blackhawks? And right away, it's no question, Doug Wilson, Keith Brown, and Bob Murray. And they're all gone. Let's go to Al Trutwig right now.
Well, Gary, 1968, and it says on the trophy, for perpetual competition to the champion of the Campbell Conference goes this trophy. And, of course, the Oilers have held it high for the past couple of years. Back to you, Gary.
Well, it has been the perpetual motion here in this game. The first two periods, not a pretty sight as Bob Murray is helped off the ice, his eyes covered by the towel. Unable to see where he was being led as they try to work him down to the locker room. We have a minute 56 seconds to go in this second. 6-4, the Blackhawks holding the two-goal lead. They already are without Doug Wilson and Keith Brown on the defense, and now Murray. From the point, the shot kicked out by Bannerman. It is Curry who plays it behind. Bannerman gets the stick on it and gets it away from Gretzky. Here's Troy Murray on top of things. Kozar with Olchek on him. Ben Wilson slaps at it as the Blackhawks now just want to get out of this period holding the two-goal lead, and they'll put that puck anywhere just to keep it away from in front of Bannerman. A minute and a half to go.
Well, okay, it's down to this man, number 23, Ben Wilson. He's got the most experience back in the blue line, and so he's going to have to log a lot of ice time in the remainder of this hockey game. You can see number 23, Ben Wilson, doing a little bit of the aggressive play when he knocked over number 4, Kevin Lowe, one of the Oilers. Ben Wilson's aggressiveness is going to have to continue in this hockey game.
Wilson, O'Callaghan, DuPont, Bergevin, and Boyd. Here's the shot. Slipped by Bannerman as he puts it high into the crowd.
That's twice right off the faceoff that Charlie Huddy has gotten off excellent shots. Ones that Ernie Bannerman has had to react very, very quickly on. Look at Jerry Curry with Gretzky being covered the way he is. It's time for this man to shine. He can really show some of his individual efforts.
Gretzky takes the faceoff. He'll be looking for number 17. Jerry Curry, a 71-goal scorer this year. And it is cleared out. A minute 15 to go in his second period. Huddy chasing it down, being watched by Fraser, who turns him around. Curry with Olczyk hawking him. And now Lowe over the blue line. The wrist shot. And Bannerman clears it himself. It appears as if the Blackhawks are playing a man down. 50 seconds left in the second period. Bergevin keeps it in. Rick Patterson, 26 for the Hawks. Into the boards by Lowe. And it is Curry starting it out, looking for Gretzky, who's trying to sneak behind the defense. Tricky puck, and Fuhrer steers that aside. Now Pozar with some room. Four Hawks come back. Pozar carrying. And the Oilers offside.
Well, it was Wayne Gretzky way off on the right wing side that was able to get on the ice without Troy Murray really noticing too much where he was positioned. Pozar carrying the puck, but just hanging on to it a little bit too soon before doing anything with it.
There's the arithmetic on the old scoreboard of the Chicago Stadium. 6-4 in favor of the home team with 21 seconds to go in the second period of action. Game 5 Tuesday night in Edmonton. And many of the fans in Edmonton never even thought that this series would get back there Tuesday night. It will indeed. Savard faces off against Krushelnicki. Nelnik and Sutter gets his stick on that. 15 seconds left. Gregg, lead pass to Lindstrom. And Bannerman plays it to his defense. 5 seconds. A shot blocked in front. And now the Blackhawks could rest for 15 minutes before coming out for the third period with a two-goal lead. As the teams head off the ice after the second period of play. Coming up, without coverage, will be Jack Fowler of Sports Illustrated covering this series. After two-thirds of play, the score, the Chicago Blackhawks, 6.
And that just opened up all the room that Steve Larmer needed, and you don't give a big goal scorer like Steve Larmer that opportunity.
Chicago maintains that two-goal lead. They headed into that second period with a two-goal lead, and Edmonton seemed to put the pressure on, and they cashed in on a fluke-type goal off of Bannerman by Lindstrom.
I think Bannerman was doing exactly what you had indicated, maybe just napping a little bit, didn't have a great deal of work. The Chicago Blackhawks are in some trouble back behind that blue line, but for 20 minutes, they might just be able to bail themselves out. They've got to continue playing the way they did, I think, in that second period. They tightened up a little bit more, but it's still been a pretty wide-open hockey game, and in order to protect the lead, Chicago Blackhawks have got to play the way they can play, discipline-wise in their own end zone, take the body. They really took the body well on the key players for the Edmonton Oilers.
Well, you know exactly how fired up the Chicago Blackhawks are in their locker room right now. What do you think's happening in the Edmonton locker room?
Well, I'll tell you, since I had a supreme effort in games number 3 and 4 to get back in this series, and right now the Oilers have been facing a tough Blackhawk team. They've been facing this big, noisy crowd, and also one thing you have to talk about is the fact that they're facing this ice surface, which is one of the smallest in the National Hockey League. Most ice surfaces are 200 feet wide or long. This is 185 feet long, so it takes away 15 feet of the neutral zone. As the Chicago Blackhawks
Mitchell here takes the ice, and a chance for us to remind you once again that the Herbal Ice Special will be seen immediately following tonight's hockey.
Like more ice to roam and open it up. They don't have it here. How does that affect these two games?
Al, this ice serve is very similar to Boston Garden. And a lot of people don't realize that as far as dimensions go. For some reason, the Chicago Stadium ice surface looks bigger than the Boston Garden. I just don't think that ice surface, whether or not it's 15 feet shorter than they're accustomed to playing on, really isn't an excuse on the Edmonton Oilers' part. They're a hockey club that can skate, and they can skate hard and fast, and so what it means is you should be able to get to the goal that much quicker when you don't have that extra 15 feet to go to. So I think that excuse can really be thrown in the bucket. What the Edmonton Oilers have not been able to do is break away from their checks. You mentioned about the great effort that Murray Bannerman and the rest of the Chicago Blackhawks gave in game number 3, and of course, in the first two periods of tonight's game. I think that as Glenn Sather looks on from behind his Edmonton Oilers bench, that Bob Fulker to be the first to say that it doesn't matter the great effort now that you gave to this team in the first and second period. What's important is what are you going to get for us and to us here in the third period in this crucial game in Chicago.
Murray Bannerman has faced 21 shots. Grant Fuhr has faced 20. It's been a light night for Bannerman, who in the playoffs has seen 41 shots a game. Busting in. The Oilers, Curry, right in front, and it's clear across the crease. Golden opportunity as the defenseman Larry Melnick makes the rush down ice, but unable to put it in the open net. Here is Frazier. Loses. Kept in. Bob Murray, number 6 for the Blackhawks, has been stitched up and is back on the ice starting this third period. Gretzky with Yaremchuk running at him. And Randy Gregg plays it around. Starting the third period of action, the Blackhawks lead by 2, hoping to tie up this series at 2 games apiece. O'Callaghan shoots it in to the Edmonton zone, where Randy Gregg goes back to get it. And Coffey, who has been stifled tonight, plays it ahead. Napier leaves it behind, and it's intercepted by Sutter. Walk pass to Larmer. Larmer with 2 Oilers back, and they upset him. Charlie Huddy. It goes to Napier on the left wing. Circled around by O'Callaghan. Napier cuts into the slot. He'll get his backhand off. Save, rebound. Oh, what a save by Bannerman. Reaching out. Savard back the other way. Skates into the corner, right in front. And the tip by Larmer goes wide. Larmer again. And his shot is smothered by the defense. Now with a 2-goal lead, the Oilers now facing Murray Bannerman, who was unconscious on that last save. The Blackhawks lead by 2, but the Oilers have to beat Bannerman tonight here in this third period.
Well, and Bannerman went down, chin around Murray Bannerman, and here he makes the initial save. You can just see that he slid across. Murray Bannerman definitely lots of action in tonight's game. Bannerman still doing a lot of work here. He makes the initial save, the rebound goes out, and how he got this one, I don't know, but again, a little bit of luck going for him there as well. He was down in the ice, got a piece of it with his glove, but the Oilers were guilty of not getting that puck up high.
You remember the SWAT team. He swatted away. We have played 2 minutes of this third period. You know the Oilers will be storming out, trailing by 2 goals. Lysiak has Secord on the left wing. Lysiak, his shot is smothered. And Lumley back the other way. Ahead to Pozar, who has scored tonight for the Oilers. Messier behind the net. Messier still with the puck. Cross ice to Fogelin. Loses to Secord. Racing for the puck. With low back, he shoots. Save made by Fuhr. O'Callaghan bats it back in. As this place is buzzing, as Chicago goes on the attack. Best defense is a good offense. Messier. And he rolls it deep into the Chicago zone.
Bannerman helps out his defenseman, Ben Wilson. Lead pass to Lysiak, waiting in the neutral zone. And it is shot into the Edmonton end. Line change for the Hawks. You know they're going to be changing quickly in this third period. Anderson squeezes by DuPont. Unable to get by Fraser. And it is lugged out by DuPont, the young defenseman. Loses on a poke check. Anderson to Curry to Anderson. Great play by Bannerman. Came out of nowhere. Fraser back the other way. Fraser heading in. He shoots. And it goes wide. So it is Bannerman now slamming the door shut on the Edmonton Oilers. He's down by two. Coast-to-coast coverage in a Stanley Cup playoff. Only a USA Sports.
The pass, he lets it go right away. Murray Bannerman coming over to his left and just comes up with a spectacular save. The Blackhawks are getting a great effort out of Bannerman in goal.
That looked a little easier. Keep in mind that was in slow motion. Puck did not come to him that slowly. And they have really stopped Anderson. Assault again, and Bannerman is ready for it. Kuchelnicki. It is Savard. Hemming it in the corner. Dug out by Kuchelnicki. Turned around by O'Callaghan. Kuchelnicki stays with it. Huddy the shot. On the screen, it is Bannerman who finds the puck.
Bannerman comes outside of his crease in order to get a good look at that puck coming at him, and he nabs it and has a little difficulty going back into his crease. One thing about the Blackhawks right now is they can stay on the attack and try to keep that third man back, but that's difficult to do and still not get caught on going for yourself.
The Blackhawks finished 26 points behind Edmonton, only three games over 500, but since Pulford took over early in February, they're 24-11-4. It is a new Blackhawk team. Savard clears it out. Coffey swings and misses. And O'Callaghan goes back for it. We have played 4.5 minutes in this third period. Chicago 6. And here is Savard. Behind the back to Sutter. And Coffey broke that one up. 6-4. Chicago leads it. Sutter scrapping for the puck. He is nailed there. Right in front. Score!
Go ahead by the score of 7-4. Nice play by Darryl Sutter, Dennis Savard, and Steve Larmer. This combination is putting the puck in the net finally in this series.
Larmer gets his second of the night. Eighth in the playoffs. Third against Edmonton. And the place goes wild.
Oh, it's nice to come home, isn't it, for the Chicago Blackhawks? The Mars line got going in game number three, and they haven't stopped.
4:52 is the time. Sutter and Savard on the assist. Savard now with a goal and two assists in the game. Moves a point behind Gretzky in the playoff scoring. Here's Messier. He shoots, and he rings that off the post. Three-goal lead for the Chicago Blackhawks. 7-4 is the score. Picked up by Patterson. Patterson in front to Murray. He scores.
beautiful shot by Bob Murray and a nice pass from Rick Patterson and the Edmonton Oilers. They're down 8-4 now. There's the shot by Murray, and that will be the last chance that Grant Fuhr gets to see the puck in tonight's game. As you can see it from another angle, Grant Fuhr is leaving the game in place of Andy Moog.
Bob Murray, you see the bandage on his forehead to cover the stitches. He gets his third playoff goal, Patterson and Secord the assist, at 5:24. And they are hanging from the rafters. This joint is different. Andy Moog must say, isn't that kind of nice? They come into the game and they give me a standing ovation. Andy Moog has played just 5 minutes in the playoffs. He's perfect. No goals. He has 14 minutes, 36 seconds ahead of him. It has been a long night for Grant Fuhr. 8 goals in this game. He had given up 9 in the first 3. So Andy Moog, who hurt his knees in a game back on March 4th, has not started since Fuhr started the last 23. Right in front, Curry swings and misses. Curry kicked out by Bannerman. And this two-goal assault by the Blackhawks, inspired by the play of Murray, Bannerman in goal, making two spectacular saves to thwart the Oilers as they try to make up a two-goal deficit coming into this third period. Mulder this year, an all-star goalie along with his teammate Grant Fuhr. And it is whistled down. It's the place to stay for live family cup coverage. USA Sports, hope you're enjoying the action.
That of goaltending hasn't seen much playoff hockey. Since tonight, Murray Bannerman has been spectacular. Grant Fuhr has been very average, and as a result, the Blackhawks have a commanding lead.
Well, Bannerman has been spectacular. Frazier goes in, it won't count. Offside against the Hawks.
That doesn't matter. These fans are here anyway. It may be offside, but as far as they're concerned, their Hawks can't be beaten in tonight's game, and they'll throw the toilet paper, rolls, and everything else on the ice right now because Kirk Frazier came close enough.
Andy Moog upset that the shot was taken, but Gary had indicated earlier there's no way to even hear the whistle here at the Chicago Stadium. It has been deafening for two games. And whereas Glenn Sather's Oilers embarrassed the Hawks in game one, 11-2, the Blackhawks may be returning the favor here tonight in game number 4.
Sather's got to be wondering as to what he is going to be able to do in this Chicago Stadium in order to get Wayne Gretzky and Jari Kurri and Mark Messier and Glenn Anderson, really four of the key performers, offensively going.
Well, what he'll have to do is make sure he wins at home, where they have two more games. Remember, in the series against Minnesota, Blackhawks won 4-2. Here is Murray coming up again with Darryl Sutter. Can't get the backhand off. The two games that Minnesota won were both here in Chicago. Edmonton has not had the same good fortune. Bannerman looking for another assist. He had one Thursday night. He has one again here tonight. So he's leading the goaltenders in that statistic.
Well, he's really been effective with that stick. He has made clearing passes, and he's thrown the puck out of danger a number of times.
Savard through the legs. Shot. What save by Moog as he gets into the swing of things very quickly. By a local system, we'll pause now. You're watching the Stanley Cup playoffs only on USA.
Territory once again, and we're going to take a look at some of the excellent action here once again by the Blackhawks, and watch as Steve Larmer gets his shot away. He goes for the upper corner, but Andy Moog gets into the game and gets into it early by coming up with a big glove save.
Once again, a program responding here once again tonight and leading the Edmonton Oilers, the defending champions, 8-4. It is Randy Gregg. All sorts of room, and the tip off the stick of Lindstrom goes wide. Larmer clears but not out. Napier with Savard right on him. From the point, it's blocked by the defense. Sutter laps at this one as Bannerman stops Krushelnicki from getting to the puck. Bergevin golfs at it. Still in the Chicago zone, but a high stick is called against
the record that was set by Bobby Hull in playoffs, and that was also 25 points. So Dennis Savard, the leader offensively for the Blackhawks, that is a Blackhawk team record. And of course, the great number nine, Bobby Hull, had that record before Dennis Savard has now equaled.
And Savard with the 25 points, now one behind Gretzky for the playoff lead. Now once again, the Blackhawks doing the job on number 99. He scored the first goal of the game, and that has been it. Long since forgotten. Messier drops it off to Anderson. Huddy walking in, fires, saved by Bannerman. Rebound as a penalty being called on the Blackhawks. Now they're shoving behind the net. Secord, number 20, for the Hawks. Messier is in there.
The Blackhawks are definitely going to be penalized, and as long as things are even up, this will give the Edmonton Oilers a chance in the power play.
With the score, Chicago 8 and Edmonton 4. This is USA's exclusive Stanley Cup. Chicago, the Oilers are 0-3 in power play attempts in this game. So they are now 2-13 in the series against Chicago. Kept in by Yari Curry at the point. Across to Coffey. The tip by Messier, and Bannerman seals it. A 10-year veteran who has played all of his years with one team. And there he is, drilling it around. Curry can't keep it in. Near steal by Lutzik, who had all ice in front of him. Now Lutzik has the puck. Lutzik seeing more and more action here tonight, with Troy Murray getting so much time and Phil Gardner out. Lutzik slaps at it and then whacks at it.
Boy, the determination of these Blackhawks have really got the Edmonton Oilers a little disorganized and confused out there offensively.
Glenn Anderson goes in, and it is smothered by Bannerman. There goes the net. And Bannerman is slow to get up.
When it comes to cutting in on goal, Glenn Anderson has got plenty of points in the bravery department. He took that post and Bannerman. Attempted to go for it. Let's watch Anderson. And see the way he picks up the puck now. He cuts. He's really deep already, but he's going to cut. He gets that left leg out and tries to protect the puck. Number two, Bergevin, was coming from behind and trying to take out Anderson, but that's not easy. Anderson's such great speed. Watch Bannerman here. Bannerman goes down. I'll tell you, Glenn Anderson was pretty lucky that he did not get his face slashed open by Murray Bannerman's skate. Bannerman's skate came up dangerously high right in the direction of Glenn Anderson's face.
10:59 left. A minute and 11 remaining in the penalty to Patterson, and an 8-4 lead for the Chicago Blackhawks. Murray Bannerman, who for several years was the caddy for Tony Esposito here in Chicago and sat on the bench when these fans were yelling the chorus of Tony, Tony. And now it has changed to Murray. And we've heard it here tonight.
Messier tried to go back to the point with that pass to Coffey. Wasn't even close. And Brown has been attacking aggressively and doing an excellent job of defending.
O'Callaghan whips it around. Larmer with two goals here tonight. Shoots it out. And Posar plays it back to center. Anderson. He had two goals in each of the first two games in Edmonton. He had six goals in the three-game regular series against the Blackhawks. But he has been stopped tonight and also in Game 3. Posar, been one of the most effective Oilers. There he is, slaps it. Smothered by Bannerman. Posar stays with it, puts it in front. And we have another Chicago penalty coming up. So the Oilers certainly having their opportunities, but they have not been cashing in on the power play. For our local system, we'll pause now. It's the Stanley Cup playoffs only on USA Sports. Behind. crowd here in Chicago, perhaps a bit prematurely, with a chant of "We're number one."
9 minutes to go. I wouldn't be chanting that yet.
Well, they have a reason to be carried, get carried away. Great effort again by the Blackhawks, who are playing three key men down. Here's Gretzky weaving in. Gretzky shadowed the last two games. Coffey right in front. But Curry has to go back to get it.
For some reason, the Edmonton Oilers have to
block by the defense and clear out.
Well, John Muckler, the assistant coach, Al says there's a big difference, however, being at home, being within your own routine and preparing for the next series versus sitting around in somebody else's city.
Here's McClellan busting in. McClellan with O'Callaghan. Krushinski digs it out. Gretzky looking for the pass. It was Krushinski sitting on top of Barryman. And Chicago clears. 20 seconds left in the penalty to Sutter. It was 6-4 Chicago coming into this third period. The Blackhawks have added two more goals. Bannerman. Lumley for Edmonton. Cross ice. Kevin Lowe watched by Lutzer. McClellan. As he laps Bob Murray. Play continues. There's a hesitation. Lowe, his shot on the screen. Bannerman has it. Doesn't know it, but he does. Coast to coast, only on USA Sports. We are perched here at USA, up in the second balcony here at the Chicago Stadium, and our bird's eye view onto the ice and bringing you all the action on USA Sports, the Stanley Cup playoffs on USA.
Well, let's go back into the Chicago Blackhawks end zone and see Bob Murray colliding with number 24, Kevin McClellan, who is back out on the ice for that shift.
Teams at equal strength, back-to-back power plays by the Oilers, and they come up dry. 6.5 minutes left in this third period. 8-4, Chicago leading it. Both series on the way to being tied as Quebec beat Philadelphia tonight to tie that series at 2 games apiece. Lysiak, he is double teamed. Messier with some stick handling, with Secord covering him. Now Bergevin has some room, but a couple of Hawks were still offside. Lysiak has lost his helmet and has a couple of choice words.
I'll tell you, Lysiak and Al Secord on that line playing together tonight have really performed well. In fact, I think that's one of their strongest games in playoffs so far this season. It's all tied up.
And also the thoughts of perhaps having Doug Wilson back for game number 5 Tuesday. Here's Randy Boyd. His slapper on the screen went wide. If he put that one on target, Randy Boyd may have had a moment to always cherish. Gretzky collects the pass, goes behind the back to Curry. His slap shot, and a save by Bannerman. Gretzky fires, and he puts that one into the crowd. And we are now down to 5 minutes and 30 seconds. You all the action on USA. Bob Murray, who has a goal along with his stitches tonight. McClellan brings it out for the Oilers. This is Hunter. DuPont behind on that. Collision course with Lumley. There goes the net tilting over. And now it is McClellan who takes the run at DuPont.
Well, you might know if McClellan was on the ice the way things have gone tonight that he was going to end up in the penalty box.
And it was Randy Gregg who was really steamed trying to get at one of the Blackhawks, DuPont. DuPont skates away in the corner with a linesman with him, so he perhaps got his shots in there somewhere. We will return to the Chicago Stadium for the final 5 minutes to 9 at cruising in front. Huddy kicks it away. Toppled over by O'Callaghan. And now it is Eddie Olczyk 2-on-1 with Troy Murray. Murray shoots wide. 3.5 minutes left in this third period.
Gretzky across to Anderson. Anderson still with it. And it is O'Callaghan, but Anderson scores as Bannerman loses sight of the puck. It is an 8-5 hockey game with 3:19 remaining.
Well, Jack O'Callaghan, number 5 for the Blackhawks, got a piece of that, but it wasn't good enough. That puck came right out under the stick of Glenn Anderson, as you could see right here how it was set up. O'Callaghan got a piece of that puck and then ended up leaving it right for number 9, Glenn Anderson, who just fired it right by Murray Bannerman. Let's watch one more time. Anderson was trying to make the pass. O'Callaghan actually cut the pass off, but then when he fell, he left the puck right for Glenn Anderson.
So Anderson gets his 8th goal of the playoffs. That's his 5th in this series. He has been all over Bannerman throughout the course of the evening and finally cashes in. As a timeout has been called with 3 minutes and 19 seconds to go.
So far, the same number that was scored in game number 1, but a different story for the Blackhawks.
Balanced a little differently. It is Anderson, and he is bumped off the play by Dupont. 25 seconds for the Oilers now on the power play. Once it gets back there for Chicago, again doing their fine job forechecking. They are all over the Oilers here in the Chicago Stadium. Anderson ahead to Lumley. Lumley tries in. Anderson. And that one deflection of the crowd.
Nielsen is a co-coach.
Colford, who took over early in February, if the Hawks hold on tonight, will be 25-11-4 since the time he took over. The face-off to the right of Bannerman. Messier takes the draw along with Lysiak. Busting out Troy Murray. Remember, the Edmonton net is wide open. Here's Coffey for the Oilers. Leap pass to Gretzky. He has Messier streaking in and scores!
Oh, nothing's impossible.
It is a 2-goal hockey game. 2 minutes and 15 seconds to go. And you just think, if the Oilers had only struck at one of the many power play attempts they have had tonight.
Mark Messier turning on those jets. And boy, can he fly when he has the opportunity. Paul Coffey, number 7, just feeds a nice pass right here. And after Gretzky had given it to Messier, Messier walked right around Bannerman. So now things change a little bit here. And the Blackhawks have called timeout. Bob Pulford's going to try and calm his team down and give them some instructions as to how he expects them to defend or attack, whichever the case may be. Let's watch one more time there. You can see how far Bannerman was out of the net, right on the seat of his pants. That's what a move Mark Messier put.
Across to Curry. He fires. Kick save by Bannerman.
Big one by Bannerman. Right off the draw, the Oilers win it. And now they've got another good chance to score. Murray Bannerman makes the save. You can see the tension on the Edmonton Oilers bench here because they know that it is not impossible yet. Let's watch. There's the shot coming from Yari Curry, and Bannerman just kicks it out into the corner.
The perfect setup for the Oilers, and only 6 seconds tick off the clock. A minute 17 remaining. A long finish to the Chicago Blackhawks. They thought that this one was sewn up with a 4-goal lead. And again, it is Messier taking the draw against Lane, thanks to Anderson. Anderson works his way. Back it goes to Coffey. Bannerman comes out. Anderson the shot. And we have a penalty. It's against Edmonton. Dave Lumley gets the hook. A minute to go, and that gets a reaction from the crowd. Lysiak shoots it out. You know what Chicago is trying to do, just keep that puck from coming into their zone. 50 seconds left. Chicago 8, Edmonton 6.
The Blackhawks were turning off for some reason. I think they forgot they got the power play.
Here's Secor with Moog out of the net. Hands on the shot. DuPont can't bring it in because
He had a teammate in the zone, Troy Murray, had yet to come out. 29th players in the defensive four, Doug Wilson and Keith Brown. Then in the beginning of game three, they lose a very valuable pools against the Oilers. In game four, you see the time remaining in this game. Mogis back in goal, and Troy Murray floats it in.
You know, I said you couldn't beat the Edmonton Oilers by playing some pretty wide-open hockey, but the Blackhawks have got great goaltending. They've played some wide-open hockey tonight, and they're beating the best in the game at that type of hockey.
And the countdown from the big crowd. The Chicago Blackhawks have done it. After losing the first two games in Edmonton, they have come back and won the next two in Chicago and have evened the series at two games apiece. They will go to Edmonton on Tuesday for game number five. Many felt, especially the fans in Edmonton, that the series would have never left Chicago. Coming up, the mobile player of the game will join Al Cotwin for Ponderies. It's now tied at two games apiece.